गुड आफ्टरनून डियर स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एनाटॉमी SRTR मेडिकल कॉलेज अंबा जोगई। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस द थैलेमस। बिफोर वी प्रोसीड फॉर टुडेज टॉपिक, फर्स्ट वील सी व्हाट द डायनसेफेलॉन इज। द डायनसेफेलॉन वी हैव सीन ब्रेन स्टेम, मिड ब्रेन। नाउ सेरेब्रम हैज टू पार्ट्स, टेलेनसेफेलॉन एंड डायनसेफेलॉन। द डायनसेफेलॉन इज सिचुएटेड अबोव द मिड ब्रेन in the core of cerebrum. It is divided into two parts, pars dorsalis and pars ventralis. Pars dorsalis consists of thalamus, metathalamus, which has medial geniculate body, lateral geniculate body, epithalamus, which consists of pineal gland, habenular nuclei, and pars ventralis consists of hypothalamus and subthalamus. So today we are going to discuss about the thalamus, that is the also known as dorsal thalamus, pars dorsalis, it's a part of. So the thalamus is a large ovoid mass of gray matter. It is mainly formed of gray matter, thalamus is, and very little white matter or white tissue is there. So it is situated inside. Here you can see, this is the cerebral hemispheres, two cerebral hemispheres. These are the frontal lobes. Here we can see, these are the occipital lobes, and here we have the temporal lobe. We have removed, in this section we have removed the parietal lobe so that we can see the situation of this green mass. You can see is the thalami, two thalami, right and left. They are situated one besides the other, ovoid in shape. They are two ends, anterior end, posterior end, and four surfaces. We'll see external features one by one. So here you can see they are located in the core of cerebral hemisphere like this, on either side of cavity of third ventricle. This here you can see is the cavity of lateral ventricle. This, the above the lateral ventricle, here you can see the corpus callosum. Here in between two ventricles, two lateral ventricles, we have septum pellucidum, and here you can see the cavity of third ventricle. On either side of cavity of third ventricle, third ventricle is cavity of diencephalon, we know. So on either side of cavity of third ventricle, these two large masses of gray matter, they are known as thalamus, they are located. They are ovoid in shape, not exactly ovoid, they are egg-like. Egg is ovoid in shape, but one end is narrow of the egg as compared to the other end, which is broader. So anterior ends are narrow and posterior ends are broader for this thalamus. Its size in length, it approximately measures 3.5 centimeters, and in width it is 1.5 centimeters. So 3.5 by 1.5 each thalamus measures. Its long axis is directed backward and laterally. Here you can see backward and laterally, so that anterior ends are bit nearer to the midline as compared to the posterior ends. So this is the situation of thalamus. Thalamus is the great sensory. Why do we need to study thalamus today? It is known as great sensory gateway. Means all the sensory modalities, say general sensations, say special sensations, whatever the sensory inputs are coming towards cerebrum from lower centers, they are relayed in thalamus, and from thalamus, thalamic radiations arise and then they are taken to respective parts of cerebrum. So it is great sensory gateway. Structurally, the presenting parts for thalamus are two ends, anterior end and posterior end. Four surfaces, superior surface, inferior surface, medial surface and lateral surface. Here in this diagram, this picture is taken from above. This diagram in above, you can see this narrow tapering end is the anterior end of thalamus. So anterior end is narrow, tapering towards midline, it is nearer to midline, it forms posterior boundary of interventricular foramen. It forms posterior boundary of interventricular foramen, anterior end. The posterior end, you can see here, is broad as compared to the anterior end. It is known as pulvinar. It is known as pulvinar. This is groove on the surface of pulvinar, and this posterior end, it is free, it is away from midline, and it overhangs the medial and lateral geniculate bodies, superior colliculi and its brachium. So this is the posterior end. This way you can see anterior end narrow and posterior end broad. And here we have the cavity of third ventricle. Now four surfaces. This is the coronal section showing us the four surfaces. This coronal section is, this is thalamus. Here this is cavity of lateral ventricle. This is cavity of third ventricle. In this diagram, here we can see this surface is the superior surface of thalamus. Superior surface is in its lateral half is related to cavity of lateral ventricle. It forms the floor of lateral ventricle in its lateral half, while medial half of a superior surface is related to telechoroidy and choroid plexus of third ventricle. That is, telechoroidy is the fold of pyameter that encloses the choroid plexus. For third ventricle, it is situated on the medial half of superior surface. These are the relations of, one more relation, thalamostriate vein. Here you can see. So, thalamostriate vein, cavity of lateral ventricle and telechoroidy and choroid plexus of third ventricle is in relation of superior surface. A thin sheet of white matter covers the superior surface, that is known as stratum zonale. Now, inferior surface. Inferior surface in its anterior part is related to subthalamus. The name subthalamus itself tells you it is situated below the thalamus, so its name is subthalamus. So, obviously, inferior surface is in its anterior half is related to subthalamus. Posterior half of inferior surface is free, forms the pulvinar and is in relation of medial and lateral geniculate bodies. So, inferior surface. These are relation of inferior surface. Here, this is the medial surface. The medial surface forms lateral wall of third ventricle. The medial surface forms lateral wall of third ventricle. Some fibers, they do connect two thalami to each other. They are known as interthalamic adhesions. This interthalamic adhesions arise from the medial surface on either side. They are passing through the cavity of third ventricle towards the opposite phalo. So, interthalamic adhesions are in relation of medial surface. The lateral surface forms medial boundary of posterior limb of internal capsule. What is internal capsule with white matter? We will see. It is the bundle of white matter that is going to the cerebral cortex. With white matter, we are going to study it in detail. But this internal capsule has anterior limb, posterior limb. This posterior limb is situated here and it is forming the thalamus is forming the medial boundary of this posterior limb. So, these are the relations of four surfaces. Superior surface, we have seen. Inferior surface, we have seen. Medial surface, we have seen with interthalamic adhesions, and lateral surface forming the medial margin of internal capsule. So, this is about the gross features of the thalamus. Now, internal structure. External structures we have seen. When we say the internal structure, we study the internal structure in two parts, white matter and gray matter. As thalamus is a large ovoid mass of gray matter, white matter is very minimal in the thalamus. Very minimal. It has got external medullary lamina, stratum zonale, and internal medullary lamina. In this diagram, you can see these green linings, they are covering the lateral surface of thalamus. So, this lateral surface is nothing, white matter linings, these are nothing but the external medullary lamina. This external medullary lamina is covering the lateral surface of thalamus and it is separating the thalamus from this internal capsule. Stratum zonale is a thin sheet of white matter that is covering superior surface. दीज आर ऑन द सर्फेसेस एक्सटर्नल एंड एक्सटर्नल मेडुलरी लैमिना एंड स्ट्रैटम जोनेली आर ऑन द सर्फेस ऑफ द थैलेमस व्हाइल इंटरनल मेडुलरी लैमिना इट्स नेम इटसेल्फ टेल्स अस इंटरनल दिस शीट ऑफ व्हाइट मैटर हियर यू कैन सी अ वाई शेपेड sheet of white matter is passing through the core of thalamus and it is dividing the thalamus into three parts as it is y shaped it has got this is a stem of y which bifurcates near the anterior end to enclose a small area it divides the thalamus into three parts internal medullary lamina is this structure passing through the core of thalamus dividing thalamus into three parts so only this much white matter is there now gray matter is nuclei mainly all the nuclei of the thalamus are the constituents of this gray matter we need to understand this part very well because thalamus is nothing but gray matter only nothing but nuclei only If you want to understand various connections of thalamus, you need to understand this nuclei, situation of nuclei. So various nuclei, this here in this diagram, you can see this red tissue is internal medullary lamina bifurcating anteriorly and enclosing the anterior part. So the thalamus is divided into anterior part, which is denoted in this diagram by blue color. This medial part which is denoted by brown color and lateral part which is denoted by yellow color so these are the three main parts internal medullary lamina is making and we'll study nuclei in each group one by one so anterior group is this group collectively all the gray matter is known as anterior nuclei various mammalothalamic tract is related to this we'll see with the connections so anterior group of nuclei or anterior nuclei collectively is this group then medial group is the second largest group this medial part consists of two groups medial dorsal group and medial ventral group of nuclei here in this diagram what you see is medial dorsal group this medial dorsal group is this group and medial ventral group is also there so medial part is divided into two groups lateral part is this large one this yellow depicted in yellow color is the lateral part this lateral part again is divided into dorsal tier of nuclei and ventral tier of nuclei this dorsal tier is this group this dorsal tier group has this nucleus is lateral dorsal nucleus this nucleus is lateral posterior nucleus and this posterior end this large nucleus forming posterior free end is the pulvinar so these three nuclei lateral dorsal lateral posterior and pulvinar are forming the dorsal tier group of lateral part see no confusions dear students medial part is divided into medial dorsal and medial ventral while lateral part is also divided into dorsal and ventral so this dorsal and ventral of lateral are large groups so they are known as dorsal tier and ventral tier in dorsal tier we have seen lateral dorsal lateral posterior pulvinar three nuclei while ventral tier this whole side is the ventral tier group of nuclei here we have ventral anterior nucleus then we have ventral lateral nucleus and ventral posterior nucleus this ventral posterior again is divided into ventral intermediate group ventral posteromedial ventral posterolateral for understanding thalamus for connections this ventral tier nuclei are very important and very specific fibers are coming very specific lemnisci are coming in this group so ventral anterior ventral lateral and ventral posterior. These are the nuclei in the ventral tear, where ventral posterior is again subdivided as ventral intermediate, ventral posteromedial, ventral posterolateral. Apart from this, the metathalamus consists of apart from these three large groups, some non-specific small nuclei are also consists of this thalamus. Out of this, this stem of internal medullary lamina, there is some scattered gray matter tissue. They are known as intralaminar. Here I have written intralaminar. So intralaminar nuclei are in the stem of internal medullary lamina. There are small groups of nuclei which are scattered. Then midline nuclei. Midline nuclei are medial to medial group here and lateral to interthalamic adhesions. So at this level we have midline groups of nuclei, some small non-specific these nuclei are. These are then the pulvinar overhangs medial and lateral geniculate bodies. Conventionally, medial and lateral geniculate bodies were thought as parts of metathalamus, but nowadays, as they are also the terminal receiving ends for the optic and auditory pathways, this medial and lateral geniculate bodies are considered as part of thalamus. So we'll study them under thalamus only. So this is about the nuclei. I'll revise in 1 minute, because if you understand the nuclei, then only you will understand the connections. So in fast 1 minute, we'll revise. This internal medullary lamina divides the thalamus into three parts: the large anterior group, collectively known as anterior nuclei. Then second largest is the medial group. This medial group is divided into medial dorsal and medial ventral group, and the lateral group. This lateral part is again divided into dorsal and ventral groups. This dorsal tear consists of lateral dorsal, lateral posterior and pulvinar, while ventral tear consists of ventral anterior, ventral lateral, ventral posterior. Ventral posterior again is subdivided as ventral intermediate, ventral posteromedial, ventral posterolateral. These are the specific nuclei. The non-specific nuclei are intralaminar group, then midline group, medial geniculate body and lateral geniculate body. So this is about the understanding of situation of nuclei or situation of gray matter or distribution of gray matter about the thalamus. Now we'll proceed to the connections of thalamus. The specific nuclei of the thalamus. This diagram tells us about the connections of thalamus. Here in this diagram we have shown, this left side of the diagram gives us all the afferents, that are tracts coming to the thalamus, and the right side of the diagram is telling us about the efferent, that are the optic, the radiations, the thalamic radiations that are arising from the thalamus and going to respective parts of cerebral cortex. So these are the afferents, and these are the efferents on the right side of diagram, and these are the afferents. First we'll see the afferents of each nuclei. Connections, when we try to understand the connections, first we'll see the specific connections. The exam point of view specific connections, clinically important specific connections. We see the patients in day-to-day life, and as we know, the thalamus is great sensory gateway. All the sensory modalities, say general sensations, touch, pain, temperature, proprioception, joint position and sense, then vibration, all these sensations, they are relayed in the thalamus, and from the thalamus third order neurons that are arising. Special senses, we know the taste sensations is coming to thalamus, the visual sensations, they are coming to lateral geniculate body, the auditory sensations that are coming to medial geniculate body. Only one sensation, olfaction, doesn't go to thalamus. Otherwise, all general and special senses, they pass through the thalamus, they are relayed through thalamus, and then they are passed to cerebral cortex. Only olfaction is a sense that is not relayed directly to the thalamus. It is related indirectly to the thalamus through amygdaloid body, but not directly. So, connections, when we try to understand the connections, first we will see the connections of a specific nucleus. The specific nuclei are mainly the medial and lateral geniculate body and ventral tear nuclei. Here we have seen the ventral tear nuclei, ventral anterior, ventral lateral, VPM and VPL. These are the specific nuclei and geniculate bodies. So we'll see the specific nuclei first. The ventral posterior group, which is very important, ventral posterior group is divided into VPM and VPL. We'll see afferent coming to VPM, ventral posteromedial, are trigeminal lemniscus, solitariothalamic tract. Up till now you know what the lemniscus is. So the trigeminal lemniscus carries, which sensation it is carrying? It is carrying general sensations from head, neck and face. The trigeminal lemniscus carrying general sensations means touch, pain, temperature. It is first order neurons are relayed in trigeminal nuclei in the pons. Then the lemniscus arising from pons is relayed to the thalamus. Of course, it is contralateral thalamus. So, hold the thalamus, it is receiving the sensations from contralateral side. Trigeminal lemniscus, it is receiving impulses or sensory modalities from face and head. The next tract coming to VPM is solitariothalamic tract. You know tractus solitarius. What is tractus solitarius? It is carrying spatial sense test from the tongue and pharynx. So test buds, from the test buds, the spatial sense that is arising, the test which is relayed to tractus solitarius. From solitarius, nucleus tractus solitarius, we are forming solitariothalamic tract. It is coming to thalamus and it is relayed in VPM. So VPM receives trigeminal lemniscus and solitariothalamic tract. Efferents arising from VPM, they are going to postcentral gyrus, that is the sensory gyrus, area 3-1-2 of the cerebral cortex. Postcentral gyrus in the parietal lobe we have, and it is area 3-1-2. The efferent arising from VPM are going to this postcentral gyrus. The next nucleus is equally important. It is ventral posterolateral. Ventral posterolateral, VPL, is receiving medial lemniscus and spinal lemniscus. What this medial lemniscus is receiving the exteroceptive sensations, pain, touch, temperature, from the whole the body except face and head. Face and head we have seen is carried through trigeminal, and from the body this medial lemniscus is carrying. The spinal lemniscus. The spinal lemniscus we have seen is formed by that fasciculus gracialis and cuneatus, and it is carrying the proprioceptive sensations from whole the body. So, medial lemniscus and spinal lemniscus, they are carrying the lateral spinothalamic tract, fasciculus gracialis and cuneatus, they are relayed, we have seen, in medulla, and these two lemnisci arising from the medulla through pons, midbrain, now they are relayed in VPL, ventral posterolateral. What these lemnisci are carrying? They are carrying the exteroceptive, that is pain, temperature and touch, and proprioceptive, joint position and vibration, from whole of the body except face and head. So this is almost All the general sensations are carried under these three headings, and one special sense is carried among this head by ventral posterior group of VPM and VPL of this thalamus. So this part is the most important part of today's lecture. You must have understood it. If you are not understood, go through it once again. This is about ventral posterior group. Now, ventral anterior group receives afferent from globus pallidus. Globus pallidus through subthalamic fasciculus. From below the thalamus, we have subthalamus. From the subthalamus, this fibers, the fasciculus that are arising from globus pallidus is received by ventral anterior group. What these fibers are carrying? They are carrying striatal impulses. They are carrying the striatal impulses and efferents arising from ventral anterior group. Efferents arising from ventral anterior group of nuclei are taken to premotor cortex. The motor cortex, we know, area 4, and premotor cortex is in the frontal lobe of cerebrum. It is area 6 and 8. So premotor cortex, this is. So this is about ventral anterior group. Now, one more important nucleus is ventral lateral nucleus and ventral intermediate nucleus. Here we have seen ventral VPM and VPL. Here we are seeing ventral intermediate. So ventral lateral group and ventral intermediate group receive fibers mainly from cerebellum. The fibers arising from dentate nucleus of cerebrum pass through red nucleus, we have seen, and up to thalamus. So this tract is dentatorubrothalamic. This is the feedback. What the cerebellum has given the order to function and what the cerebellum has received from the spinal cord. This feedback from the cerebellum is passing through dentatorubrothalamic. From dentate nucleus to red nucleus to thalamus, these fibers are going. So from cerebellum to ventral lateral group, these fibers are coming, dentatorubrothalamic fibers. And these fibers are nothing but the cerebellar impulses. And afferents arising from ventral lateral nuclei, ventral lateral nuclei, they go to the motor and premotor areas of cerebral cortex. Motor area here is the precentral gyrus, area 4, and premotor area in front of motor, it is area 6. So this is the feedback, what order has been given and what actually is happening for the coordination, because function of cerebellum is coordination. For this coordination, these fibers are carrying feedback to the cerebral cortex. They are area 4 and 6. So this is about ventral lateral group of nuclei, that are of connections of this nuclei. Now, medial geniculate body, it is the final destination of auditory pathway. Auditory fibers coming from this vestibulocochlear nuclei, then they are forming the auditory tract. They are passing through inferior colliculus of the midbrain, we have seen, and from this inferior colliculi, these fibers are relayed, the final destination or final relay station for auditory impulses is a medial geniculate body. Medial geniculate body, it's conspicuous and larger in size as compared to lateral, and it is receiving afferents from auditory tract. The efferents arising from this medial geniculate body, they go to primary auditory area. This primary auditory area is area 41 and 42, that is situated in the temporal lobe. With succeeding lectures, we will see it is primary auditory area that is situated in the temporal lobe, and fibers arising from medial geniculate body, they go to the primary auditory area 41 and 42. Now, the next nucleus is lateral geniculate body. It is the final destination of optic tract. We have seen the optic tract carries visual impulses from both the retina, and दिस ऑप्टिक ट्रैक्ट इज रिलेड इन द लैटरल जेनिकुलेट बॉडी. इट कंसिस्ट ऑफ फाइबर्स फ्रॉम बोथ द रेटाइना राइट एंड लेफ्ट इप्सिलैटरल एज वेल एज कॉन्ट्रालैटरल रेटाइना. दिस लैटरल जेनिकुलेट बॉडी इज रिसीविंग. The fibers arising from lateral geniculate body go to the efferents. They go to primary visual cortex. Primary visual cortex is present in the occipital lobe, that is known as area 17, also known as the striate area. Area 17 is in occipital lobe. So the fibers that are arising in various direction, the efferents that are arising in various direction from the thalami, they form the thalamic radiations. The fibers that are passing, forming superior radiations, they go to the postcentral gyrus, premotor cortex, motor cortex. The fibers that are arising from medial geniculate body, they are going to auditory area. So they are inferior, they are forming the inferior thalamic radiations. And the inferior radiations, because temporal lobe is below the level, so auditory area is in temporal lobe below the level. So inferior radiations are arising from medial geniculate body and going to primary auditory area. The posterior thalamic radiations are arising from the lateral geniculate body. Why posterior? Because occipital lobe is situated behind the thalamus and primary visual cortex is situated in occipital lobe. So posterior thalamic radiations are arising from lateral geniculate body, inferior from medial geniculate body, and remaining all are forming the superior thalamic radiations, which are going to the cerebrum. So this is about the efferents, afferents and functions. So I hope you have understood the specific functioning, collection of integration of all the sensory impulses and redistribution to various cortical areas is the connections of specific nuclei. Now non-specific nuclei of There are some non-specific nuclei also, intralaminar nuclei, then medial dorsal group, and this midline nuclei. These non-specific small nuclei, then anterior group. Anterior group of thalamus is mainly related to mammillothalamic tract. Here you can see mammillary bodies, two mammillary bodies, and mammillary bodies are sending the afferents to anterior group. In this diagram, very nicely you can see this connection of anterior group. Then the specific nuclei we have seen, what is function of this non-specific nuclei? They are not connected to, they are not directly receiving the sensations from the lower parts of brain through various lemnisci. They are receiving the afferents from the structures in the surrounding, the red nucleus, then mammillary body, and the small association areas of this region. They are sending the afferents to this non-specific nuclei, out of which mammillothalamic tract is very important, ventral anterior group. Here in this diagram you can see. So these are the connections. In this diagram you can see these fibers are going to parietal cortex, this superior fiber, these are going to the cerebral cortex, prefrontal cortex, these are going, then primary sensory area, the superior thalamic radiations, they are going like this to the primary sensory area. So this are the efferents, this diagram is telling, and these are the afferents. So this is about the connections of thalamus. So I hope you have understood this topic properly, dear students. To sum up with the functions of thalamus, it's a great sensory gateway. Great sensory gateway. Thalamus works like a post office. What a post office does is it receives letters from all over the parts of the city and the world. Then it integrates. Then afferents coming from the city are assessed and sent to various parts of the nation, say district, say outside the city level, whatever are received from the various parts of the district or state or nation are also integrated and sent to various association areas of the city. This way the post office is working similar functioning of thalamus. So we are calling it great sensory gateway, recipient and distribution to the cortex, sensory integration and relay station. It is the last relay station, the orders, it is the last relay station for all the sensory modalities. Here you should not forget, except olfaction. Olfaction is the sense that is not received directly by thalamus. It is received to amygdaloid body and from that to thalamus, but not directly it is coming. But all general sensations, exteroceptive, proprioceptive and all spatial sensations except olfaction, they are coming to thalamus. So that's why it is center for sensory integration and relay station. Now, apart from this, at its own level, thalamus can recognize some senses, pain and temperature, up to some level. This pain and temperature, not that profoundly, suboptimal level, but it can recognize at its own level, pain and temperature, the thalamus. Then, one more function of thalamus, it influences voluntary movements as it is related to basal ganglia and cerebellum. It affects, it influences the voluntary movements of the body. Then, lateral geniculate body is the final relay station for optic tract. Medial geniculate body is, its main function is integration of the auditory tract, the sensations of the auditory tract, impulses, auditory impulses. So these are the functions of thalamus. Now you might have got the idea what will happen if there is any vascular insult. Injury cannot happen directly to the thalamus, direct insult, because it is inside the core of cerebrum. But small vessels, small vascular insults in this region of thalamus lead to thalamic syndrome. Something very specific here is thalamic syndrome. What happens in thalamus syndrome is threshold for all sensory modalities is decreased. Because of this, the sensory modalities are interpreted as altered or hyper, very hyper. We also call it thalamic overreaction. Say only touch may be interpreted as severe pressure, or only pinprick can be interpreted as severe burning. So this is because threshold is decreased in the thalamic injury. This is known as thalamic syndrome. It occurs because of the vascular insult in this region. Now, one more thing, thalamic hand. Thalamic hand is abnormal position of hand. The forearm is pronated, fixed, and in abnormal position it is fixed. The movements are hampered, impaired for the contralateral side. It is of contralateral side. This happens. If at all the person tries to move the hand of contralateral side in this situation, the fine tremors and choreoathotosis may develop. So this is known as thalamic hand. Also known as, this occurs in the limb also, thalamic phantom limb is the another thing that we call it. So thalamic syndrome is very important. Because of vascular insults, threshold is decreased, thalamic hand, the hand is locked in abnormal position, movement is impaired, and if at all the person tries to move, there occurs the tremors, fine tremors. So this is about the thalamus. I hope there are no queries regarding this topic. Thank you.